Welcome back, everyone, to another NASCAR Heat 4 setup video. Today's video takes us to the Charlotte Motor Speedway. We're talking about the oval today thanks to Michael Lacano, who hit me up on Twitter asking about this track. Now, this track for me has been one of my least favorite ovals in the NASCAR Heat series going back all the way to the beginning. The reason for that is simply because it just doesn't feel like the layout is right. It feels like there's something off, particularly in turns 3 and 4, so I generally avoid this track as much as possible. It's just not fun for me to race, and you can see that at the bottom of the screen where I have no wins, no races, and no speed rating. So I spend all of my time generally at this track, outside of career mode, that is, either running practice sessions or race runs, and 100 laps in a race run, particularly if you're on 4X, can be a very long time, so it gives me plenty of time to make adjustments, do runs, without having to run an actual full race, and that's exactly what I did this time. In today's video, we're only going to be focusing on the Cup cars, but as I've talked about before, it should be very easy to take this information and move it into Xfinity and Trucks as well. One of the big changes for the physics in NASCAR Heat 4 is the addition of tire wear. Now, tire wear is going to have a huge effect on the setup that you're running, so it makes sense that we need to, before we get into setup discussion, talk a little bit about the options that I use while I'm testing for these setups. So we'll start off in the options menu under the gameplay tab, and then we're going to scroll down to tire wear and fuel consumption. Normally I do this on 2X. I don't like to go any higher because I do like long green flag runs, but I understand that some of you like to go all the way up to 4X. Player tire wear rate, I like more wear. I like maximum tire wear, so I generally test on more wear and less grip under the grip fall off. So keep that in mind. If you're playing with different settings such as less wear and more grip, then that's going to change the setup that you're going to want to use in the races. So keep that in mind as we're talking about setups. What I'll try to do in each video is let you know the particular settings, because I don't go for maximum tire wear at every track, just where I feel that it is appropriate. And also keep in mind, on the driving tab, there is a setting that you'll need to match up for the AI. So if you want maximum tire wear, then you need to have that on both the player car and the AI car. Or if you're going for less tire wear and more grip, then change that for the AI as well. Before we jump into the setup discussion, let's first talk a moment about the track and my approach to driving this track. So as I mentioned earlier, this is not one of my favorite tracks, and particularly on the oval side of things. And when I'm driving this track, it really helps to emphasize the difference between really charging a track and really attacking the track versus taking a step back and maybe letting the car glide into and off the corners and just trying to focus on being smooth. I find that when running laps around this track, I can be either 3 to 4 tenths different in lap time just by changing my driving style and maybe going from being a little too aggressive to maybe driving a little smoother. So there is a lot of time to be gained or lost based on your particular driving style. So I like to back it up just a little bit on this track. You can be extremely aggressive here, and I find that there's a couple of ways that you can drive this track, a couple of different attitudes you can use here. First, you can be extremely aggressive and try to just simply keep the throttle all the way down throughout the entire way around the track and just simply drag the brakes as needed, particularly on corner entry and maybe a little bit through the center to help the car to turn. So that's one way you can do it. Another way is to avoid the brakes altogether and simply lift going into the corners. Now, I find, particularly on new tires, that you don't need to come out of the gas completely. You can come out to maybe 50 to 75% throttle, and that will generally be sufficient to allow the car to rotate and keep up as much speed as you possibly can. So keep that in mind as we're talking about the setups today. And those setups are intended to be pretty similar, but I wanted to give you a slight variation so that you can compare and contrast these two setups and see which one works better for you. This first setup we're going to take a look at today is more for the short run or a race setup for those of you who use the lesser aggressive setups in tire wear fall off and tire wear itself. So if you're not particularly worried about tire wear, Or if you're looking for a starting point on a qualifying setup, this would be more geared toward that as opposed to the second setup we'll look at today, which is more for the longer run, high tire wear, 4X type of setup. If we take a look at the shock settings, you notice this is a little bit different than what I normally use. The 3.5 settings, which would be more normal for me, are simply because I try to keep the car as compliant and leave as big a margin for error as I possibly can. The higher the numbers you use generally on the shocks, the quicker the weight transfers will be and the quicker the car will react. So I try to back off of that as much as possible, and that's why the 3.5 settings work. Here, I wanted a little bit quicker transition because this track is, feels a little bit odd to me, and you need a little bit quicker transition, particularly through the center of the corner. So I went with a little bit higher number on the shocks. Now, we're not going to go into a great deal of detail about the individual settings, individual corners, bump versus rebound, and all that type of thing. That'll be for a different video that I'm hopefully going to get to make over the next couple of weeks. But for now, just suffice it to say that in general terms, the higher the number you use on the bump and rebound, the quicker the transitions and the quicker the steering will feel for the car. Moving on to the weight settings, front weight is at 52%, wedge is at 54%, and that is because my ultimate goal for this setup was to give you something that was stable. I would really rather give you something that's a little bit tight and allow you to make adjustments to free it up, as opposed to giving you something that was extremely fast but a little bit out of control and make it hard for you to have a starting point with this. So I made sure that it was a little bit tight and very secure. And so the front weight number you'll find, I usually adjust this for corner entry. If you find that the car is almost out of control, loose, or feels very unstable on corner entry, try bumping up the front weight to 52.5, maybe even 53 or more, and see how the car reacts. And that'll give you an idea of how you want to use the front weight. The wedge, maximum wedge is at 55% in this game. We're at 54%, so we're very close. The higher the number you use on the wedge, the slower the transition will be on the car, the slower the rotation of the car, so it generally makes the car more stable. So if you need the car to rotate quicker, then try dropping that wedge number to 53.5, 53 or lower, and that will certainly help the car to rotate better. Moving on to the spring settings, a little bit softer front springs than I would normally use. I usually like to get up around 1100 or 1200 on one or both of the front springs here. I started out using the stiffest possible springs, particularly in the right front, but backed off of that because I needed the car to rotate a little bit better. And having a stiffer left front spring than right front spring will allow the car to rotate better on entry. So if you're a little bit too loose on corner entry, then try bumping up that right front spring to maybe 950 or even 1000 and see if that doesn't tighten the car up on corner entry. On the other hand, if the car is too tight on corner entry, one of your options is to drop that right front spring a little bit or increase the difference between the left front and the right front, and that will help the car to rotate a little bit on corner entry. But keep in mind, you get the right front spring too low, particularly in this game. It seems to be very susceptible to allowing the car to roll over. There is a lot of weight transfer in this game. The car really wants to roll over. So if you get too low on that right front spring, then it can be very uncomfortable and become unstable. Moving on to the rear of the car, 500 pounds in the left rear, 600 in the right rear. 100 pounds of rear spring split really helps the car to rotate from the center of the corner off and under heavy throttle. So keep that in mind. If you find that the car is too loose under heavy throttle or from the corner, center of the corner on exit, then simply drop the rear spring split, lower that right rear spring down to something like 550 or even lower. And the closer you get the left rear and the right rear spring, the tighter the car will be through the center of the corner and on the exit. Tire pressure settings, I didn't spend a great deal of time here, so there's certainly a lot of adjustability that is left to be had. 19.5 on the left front, 20.5 on the left rear, and then 50 and 48 on the right sides. Again, just trying to keep that middle tire pressure or tire temperature somewhere in between the outside and the inside, but it's not a huge deal. It's more of a comfort thing. The lower you make the tire pressures in general, it will give you a little bit more grip and stability, but you'll lose a little bit of straightaway speed. On the other hand, if you increase the tire pressure settings, you'll get a little bit more straightaway speed, but you'll lose a little bit of grip in the corner. And of course, it will change the feel of the car. So you just have to get an idea of what feels better for you, a little bit lower or a little bit higher tire pressure settings. Moving on to the miscellaneous settings, +2.5 and -2.5 on the camber. You can certainly go up much higher or go down much lower than that. It's more of an individual feel thing, as well as taking a look at your tire temperature settings during the course of a run. If you find that the temperatures on the outside of the left front or inside of the right front are getting too high in relation to the other tires on the car, then you might want to back off the camber a little bit, lower that left front or right front in order to bring your tire temperatures back into alignment. But 2.5 didn't seem to be too far out of whack for either the left front or the right front. Front sway bar is at 1.315, which has become the standard for me in this game, simply because that tends to give me the best combination of feel in the car without making the car too tight. The higher the number you use for front sway bar, that will tend to make the car tighter. The car will not want to rotate. So if you're looking to stabilize the car that might be a little bit unstable, then putting a click or two of front sway bar will certainly allow that to happen. Moving on to the track bar, 11 inches on the left side, 10.5 inches on the right side. I dropped the right side a little bit lower than the left in order to help the car on corner entry and tighten it up on corner exit. So the higher the number you use on the left side, that will help to loosen the car up on corner entry and help it rotate. Right side is generally used for corner exit. The higher the number you use here, the more the car will want to rotate on corner exit. So keep that in mind as you're adjusting. Brake bias. I tend not to use a whole lot of brake here, but if you're going to be aggressive in the driving style and try to use as much throttle or even full throttle as much as you can around this track, then you're going to need to make sure you get your brake bias set up to either help the car rotate or to tighten the car up a little bit. The higher the number you use on the brake bias, like I'm using here, 77 up to 80%, I've even seen higher than that sometime, that will tighten the car up under braking, particularly heavy braking. So keep that in mind. If you need to, car's a little bit loose on corner entry and you need to tighten it, then maybe drag the brake a little bit with a higher brake bias number and that will tighten the car up. On the other hand, lowering this brake bias number to something like 75, 73 or lower will help the car to rotate more on corner entry. So that's an opportunity to use this if the car is feeling tight on corner entry. You can drop down the brake bias, drag the brake a little bit on corner entry, and it should help the car to rotate. As always, your personal preference is going to dictate how low or how high you go on this number, but somewhere around 75%, give or take 2 or 3%, is generally where I tend to stay. Grill tape, I spent no time on grill tape. In fact, I think 45% is the default here. If it's not, then I didn't spend very much time on it because it simply doesn't do anything in the game other than dictate whether or not your engine is overheating. That is unfortunate, and I hope that that is not always the case. But basically here with the grill tape, as long as you're not overheating, it shouldn't make any difference at all, at least until the developers address that situation. Wheel lock and steering offset are both at what I would consider my defaults, 10 degrees on the wheel lock, 0.05 on the steering offset. The steering offset in particular, make sure you don't get too high on this number because I generally like to use this number as an offset for the camber that I'm using in the front. More camber means more steering offset, less camber, less steering offset. So keep that in mind. You get too high with that steering offset and you can actually introduce a pull to the right in the car, which is certainly not something I want on an oval. Finally, moving on to the gear settings. Did not touch first through fourth gear. Those are pretty standard and well within the range that I'm looking for. The rear end ratio, 345 is as high as I would go, particularly on a short run qualifying style setup, or if you're using the less aggressive tire wear settings, simply because 345 gear will get you right up near the top end of the RPMs and get you close to that rev limiter. So keep that in mind. It's definitely possible to use something around a 333 gear and you will be perfectly fine. It all depends on whether you're trying to go for short run speed or long run speed and what type of grill tape settings you're using, as those will definitely correlate with each other. That takes care of the first setup for today. Now let's move on to the longer run, or more of the 4X style setup. We're not going to spend a great deal of time on this setup because we've already covered everything in the first setup in today's video. Most of this setup is very close, if not identical, to the other setup, simply because I wanted to show you a few slight variations on that setup, a little bit different feel, so that you can compare and contrast these. Now, this setup, as I mentioned before, is more geared toward the more aggressive tire wear and fall-off settings, 4X, that type of thing. So keep that in mind as we're going through the setup. Now, the shock settings and weight settings, very much the same as what we looked at before. So we'll move on to the spring settings. In the front of the car, you notice now that the right front is 50 pounds more than the left front, so flip-flopped over what we saw on the previous setup. And that's because I wanted to tighten the car up on the entry of the corner, also stabilize the car since this is more for heavy tire wear settings. So that's going to make the right front wear a little bit more than it would in a short run or a situation where you had the left front higher than the right front. In the rear of the car, only 30 pounds of rear spring split here, and that was entirely based on saving the right rear tire over the course of a long run under heavy tire wear settings. 30 pounds of rear spring split will certainly tighten the car up through the center and on exit, so keep that in mind. You're going to sacrifice a little bit of speed in order to save that right rear tire. Now, this particular setup for me, under 4X maximum tire wear settings, actually wore pretty close to the same front to rear, within 4 or 5 percentage points, so very nice wear over the course of the entire run. But a lot of that will be dependent upon how you drive the car. If you get ultra aggressive driving the car, you are going to burn either the right front or the right rear off of it. So keep that in mind as you're doing test runs. Moving on to the tire settings, a little bit different here, but not by a huge amount. The left front in particular is a little bit different here, but again, very small changes, and it will be up to you as to what feels the best for you. Under miscellaneous settings, you'll notice that the left front camber is a little bit less here as opposed to what we saw in the other setup, and that's simply to save the left front tire a little bit more. Try to bring the outside temp on the left front down a little bit to try to save the tire wear. But other than that, that is the primary reason, and you can certainly run a lot more camber in the left front or right front for that matter. Everything else is basically the same here. Going down to the gear settings, I'll just remind you on the gear settings that while I'm showing a 345 gear here, you're certainly, as you learn the track, as you learn the car combination, you might want to reduce this down to somewhere around a 333 gear, a little bit lower RPM, particularly over the course of a longer run. Those lower RPMs will serve to tighten the car up and can further save that right rear if that's something that you're having trouble with. That's going to do it for today. Thank you very much for joining me, and stay tuned for more NASCAR Heat 4.